Hello, I am Dr. Padmas Kulkarni. I am a medical oncologist working with Dinanath Mangeshkar Hospital, Pune. Today I will be talking with you about a topic called as pharmacogenomics. A lot of people might not have heard about it. It is said that more than 90% drugs work in hardly 30 to 40% of people. So you have same disease, same prescription, but the medicine may not work in all of them. In some patients, it will have a lot of toxicity. In some patients, it will have no efficacy. And in some others, there will be no effect or no toxicity as well. So why does it happen? Because we all are different genetically. Genetically, there could be changes in human beings called as chromosomal changes. The mutations, that is the changes in the genes, can be somatic mutations as they happen during the lifetime of a patient, or they could be germline mutations, that means they happen from birth. Now, the science of pharmacogenomics or pharmacogenetics, it deals with the genetic changes in a human being with the drug efficacy and toxicity. Initially, the term used was pharmacogenetics, that means study of a particular gene and a drug. But as our knowledge of human genome evolved, we started using the term pharmacogenomics, that means the whole genome as a template for drug efficacy and toxicity. Nowadays, pharmacogenomics and genetics, both the terms are used interchangeably. As far as the somatic mutations are concerned, these changes in the genes are very good targets for medicines. So a lot of medicines which we have been using, like rituximab in case of lymphomas, or gefitinib or erlotinib in case of non-small cell lung cancer, or imatinib in case of chronic myeloid leukemia, these are all targeting somatic mutations. These mutations make changes in a particular cell so that the cell loses control over its growth and it becomes immortal. And then when you target that particular weakness in the cell with a medicine called as targeted therapy, it prevents the immortality and tries to kill the cell. So this is the most practical application of pharmacogenomics in medical practice today. The less practice usage is of germline mutations. What do you study in that? When a drug is given into the human body, it enters the body, it needs to be absorbed into the body, it has to reach the target cell, it has to be metabolized in the body, either to activate or deactivate it, and then it has to be excreted. So at each point, there could be a receptor, there could be a metabolizing enzyme which will either convert, called as biotransform, or conjugate to make it soluble and excrete through the body. There are agents called as transporters which transport the drug across the cell membrane into the cell. At each point, there could be a problem because all these is tightly controlled by genetic mechanism. So the formation of a receptor, the transporter formation, and the transport of drug across the cell membrane, the various enzymes which control the activation or deactivation of the drug, and the excretion, everything is very tightly controlled. And at each point, there could be a mutation or a change in the gene which will cause some malfunction in the function of that particular receptor. Say for example, you have a receptor which is faulty. Usually, as we all know, we have two pairs of genes, one coming from each parent, one from mother and one from father. Now, in normal case, we expect that medicine to have a reasonable action and a tolerable side effect. That is why we use the drug in clinical practice. But in some patients, it happens that the gene involved in action of that particular receptor is changed, mutated. But in that case, the drug loses the efficacy but retains the toxicity. That is the reason in some patients, when we treat them with the same disease, they have a lot of side effects, but there may not be any effect. This is the simplest example of germline mutation. Things can get even more complicated. There could be a change in the receptor, and there could be change in the metabolizing enzyme. This is called as polygenic variation. In that case, depending on which gene is changed to what extent, you can have various permutations and combination of toxicity and efficacy. This all needs to be studied in detail, and that is what the pharmacogenomics is doing recently. To give an example, there is a drug which is commonly used in oncology, is irinotecan. Now, this irinotecan is transported to the liver, and inside the liver cell, it is activated into a metabolite called as SN38. Now, this SN38 has to be glucuronidated, and then it is excreted through bile outside the body. This is done by UGT1A1 kind of enzyme. Now, if there is a mutation in this enzyme, then the conversion of SN38 into inactive metabolite is hampered. So the SN38 gets accumulated inside the body and leads to toxicity. Now, a particular 28 type of mutation in UGT1A1 is more common in India. So yes, what I mean to say is the changes in genes are not same all over the world. They change from people to people, they change from area to area, it depends on ethnicity, it depends on environment. So there is constant interaction between environment and genes and various drugs you consume. Another example of pharmacogenomics can be a very old drug called as 6-mercaptopurine. TPMT is an enzyme which is metabolizing this 6-mercaptopurine. 6-mercaptopurine is a very important drug used to treat acute leukemias. Now, there are three common mutations in TPMT. If you treat all the patients with a standard dose of 6-mercaptopurine, a majority of normal people will metabolize the drug very quickly and they will have good effect with tolerable side effect. But the variant gene, they will not be able to process or metabolize the 6-MP, 6-mercaptopurine, as efficiently as they should be. And then there will be accumulation of the drug in the blood, and they have intolerable, many times life-threatening toxicity. So that is why there is a role of individualization of the dose. So a very simple test, you measure the mutations in a particular patient. When a patient is acute leukemia is diagnosed, you can check for the mutations of TPMT. And if the patient is found to have this dangerous mutation and he is homologous for that, that means the variant gene is present in mother and father, the genes coming from mother and father, both of them, you have to give the dose in 10% of the actual dose which is given to normal population, and the effect will be the same and toxicity will be the same. It will not be exaggerated. This is a direct clinical application of pharmacogenomics in day-to-day oncology practice. Same can be said about a drug called as 5-FU, where you study the concentration of thymidylate synthase or DPYD. Same can be said about various other drugs. So what is why it is not being used in clinical practice right now? Most important thing is ignorance. A lot of us patients as well as doctors don't know such tests do exist. They, when they exist, they are not available as easily. When they are available, we are not ready to do them because we are not ready to wait. But it is very important we accept pharmacogenomics in our day-to-day oncology practice or day-to-day practice. Because FDA of US has included pharmacogenomic information about 120 drugs related to about 50 genes in the package insert, and this is just the beginning. Time is going to come where almost all the drugs will have some genetic information inserted into their package insert. So when a patient comes to your clinic, you will be doing certain tests at one go, which will be available almost immediately. For example, for 5-FU, there is a breath test, uracil breath test, which is available, which can give you about DPYD concentration. So patient is waiting in your clinic, you ask the patient to do the test, the result will be available immediately, and then you can decide whether this patient is going to have effect or toxicity or both of 5-FU. Similarly, most of the oncology drugs, chemotherapy drugs, they are being worked up to develop antibodies. So that with the use of antibodies, we can monitor the levels of the drug in real time. There are new imaging probes which are being worked up and developed. The purpose is to try to predict which patient is going to develop toxicity vis-a-vis which patient is going to benefit from a particular drug. There are a lot of new pharmacogenomic information being investigated, like for example, mitochondrial RNA or epigenetic information or any other new DNA data which is being available from next generation sequencing. The problem is, lot of this data may not really be translated into the day-to-day practice because the things are getting more and more complicated today. What we are really as physicians need is a very simple bench to practice tools which are available at the bedside at reasonable cost, giving information which is actionable and with a very short turnaround time. And I'm sure it's going to happen in next few years, so that we have to be ready for that. Thank you.